So let's turn our attention back to what is going on in Hong Kong, and indeed actually what's been going on in terms of our relationship with Iran. We seem to be really at a point of also, should we say, diplomatic difficulty, let's put it that way, diplomatically even, with these two countries, particularly with China. This is after those Hong Kong protesters got the backing of Jeremy Hunt, the Foreign Secretary. Of course, we had that war of words between the UK, the ambassador to the UK from China, who accused the Foreign Secretary here of basically colonial attitudes towards Hong Kong, and to all intents and purposes said to Britain, keep your noses out, it's an internal Chinese matter. Of course, ignoring the fact that back in 1997 a deal was struck to have one country, two systems, and that is still in place for another 28 years until 2047, when the Chinese mainland assumes complete total authority over Hong Kong. But what happens next? Well, Jeremy Hunt says he's keeping all options open over China and Hong Kong. Let's talk to Dr. John Hemmings. He's director of the Asia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society and joins us now. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Lots of concern about what is going to happen to the people of Hong Kong. Clearly the demonstrations, I mean, at one point you had 2 million people on the streets out of a population of 7 million. Obviously widespread concern about the possibilities, the extradition laws are making it easier for the Chinese authorities to have more say over what happens in Hong Kong. Big concerns among young people that, you know, we've only got a couple of decades more where they still have some links with the West, and not just to the communist totalitarian state of China. But when Jeremy Hunt is saying he's keeping options open after this allegation of, you know, colonial attitudes, what does he mean? And realistically, what can Britain or any other country do if China do decide, for instance, to send the army in to quash these protesters?
Well, I mean, I think the UK has often overlooked its capability. China wants to have the UK as its banker. You know, they've just signed a UK-China trade deal which links up the Shanghai Stock Exchange with the London Stock Exchange. Believe you me, they didn't do it because of Shanghai. They did it because they want easy access to the amounts of credit and raising capital that they can do in London's deep, deep markets. They also want to internationalize the RMB, their currency, using London as a trade hub. And they want to send their children to our prestigious universities, and they want to put their ill-gotten gains in our tax havens. I mean, there's a number of things that Russia was in. We were in the same position 10 years ago with Russia, where they began to do things, and we thought, well, how can we do anything? We don't want to have a kinetic conflict or a war, but we don't have to make it easy for them either. We don't have to, for example, harp on about how trade is going to cost us. We do need to start putting our values back at the center of the relationship, or otherwise we're going to find ourselves backtracking on 400 years of progress.
Well, and this is the difficulty, isn't it? Because and that's why China, let's face it, gets away with extraordinary things on the world stage in terms of it being such a powerhouse. Now, 20 years ago, it was only 15th on our list of biggest trading partners. Now it's fourth. It accounts for 7.5% of all UK trade. There is no way that a lot of the very cheap goods coming into our country, a lot of financial services we sell abroad. So there's no way we're going to want to jeopardise that. So what measures could Jeremy Hunt take that wouldn't cost the economy, wouldn't cost jobs here, consumers here too much, but could allow us to assert moral authority somewhere in terms of that legal agreement? Again, it is an international treaty. It's been registered with the United Nations, which actually, it's not us being a colonial power. It is a simple matter of international law that we do have still an interest in how Hong Kong is governed.
Absolutely. I mean, that colonial term that the ambassador uses to hit us where we're vulnerable. But I think we should remind ourselves, the Britain that took Hong Kong during the Opium War is very different from the Britain that had it back.
Well, the fact that one of the protesters actually had a union flag when he was on the violent protests in the council building.
This is true. But I think in terms of, you know, your previous question, can we do this cost-free? The PRC under Xi is Xi Jinping, the president, the kind of chairman of the party there, he is really pushing hard on Chinese power. And they're using trade as economic statecrafts and leverage to push republics. And I don't think we can do it cost-free, and nor do I think we should. I mean, when a state begins to lock up 1 million or 1.5 million people in concentration camps, I think we have to begin to be willing to bear some cost. The U.S. still remains the largest economy. there is to some extent an argument that there's going to be decoupling between the PRC and the US. I don't know. None of us can predict that. But I don't think we should think that we can do this cost-free.
Let's also talk about what's been going on with Iran. Extraordinary events over the last couple of days. The Royal Marines mounting a daring operation yesterday to seize a supertanker believed to be smuggling crude oil from Iran to Syria. Of course, we've got sanctions on Syria as part of the EU. And overnight, Marines from 42 Commando descended onto the tanker on ropes for a Wildcat helicopter. Other Marines moved in on boats, storming the vessel alongside Gibraltarian police as the boat went into Gibraltar Straits. No shots were fired. Iran very, very angry and accused the British of taking part in an illegal and unacceptable seizure. However, of course, a lot of concern. The Americans had been tracking the tanker, the Grace One. They called on Britain to seize it as it entered waters off Gibraltar because, of course, they said, look, we don't think this... I think we might have just lost the line. I'll carry on, and I hope we can get John Hemmings back on. This boat, it's a huge, big 300,000-ton vessel, 1,000 feet long. It was believed to be heading to a refinery in Syria in breach of those EU sanctions imposed on the Assad regime back in 2011. Of course, this boat was supposedly claiming to that it had taken all this oil on in Iraq, where it would be allowed to take oil. But for some reason, chose not to go through the Suez Canal, but to go all the way around the whole coast of Africa, past Cape Town, all the way back up, and then coming in through the Gibraltarian Straits. No wonder, John Hemmings, that the Americans and the Brits were a little bit suspicious about where this oil was coming from and where it was going to.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, of course, we see all of this as really the drumbeat of buildup of pressure from the Trump administration and their concerns that the Obama-Iran deal was not actually working. So here we have essentially what began around North Korea as well, which is where you start to have increasing pressure on sources of revenue and on sources of energy. In this case, clearly revenue.
Yeah, indeed. Well, we shall see how that one turns out. Dr. John Hemmings, Director of the Asia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society. Thank you very much indeed for that.